Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to present the Director General of the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, Ambassador Ahmet Üzümcü.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and thank you for being here today. Following the Executive Council decision and Resolution 2118 adopted by the Security Council on 27 September, the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons has acted promptly and diligently. Within a span of 3 days, 19 experts from the organization were deployed to Damascus, and part of this team discussed with Syrian authorities the disclosure made by the Syrian government on 19 September. The rest of the team prepared the ground for the upcoming inspections. In fact, the first inspection took place on Monday, and the previous day, Sunday and Monday, 6th and 7th, and some equipment was already destroyed. And this work continues. Another inspection is being carried out today, and an additional team of 12 experts, in fact, is being deployed to Damascus. The timelines in the Executive Council decisions are tight. The initial declaration and a general plan for destruction have to be submitted by Syria by 27th October. First verification activities will have to be completed by the end of this month, and also the production facilities as well as mixing and filling facilities will have to be rendered unusable by that time. A plan for destruction has to be adopted by the Executive Council by 15th November with a view to destroying all chemical weapons capabilities by mid-year 2014. Our experts, both on the ground and here at the headquarters, are working hard to meet those targets. The mission is a joint UN-OPCW mission. We are grateful to the United Nations for their substantive support in terms of logistics and security. The UN Secretary General will soon appoint, in consultation with me, a special coordinator who will report to me and the Secretary General at the same time. This is an extraordinary situation for the OPCW. It's unprecedented, and we are at the beginning of a difficult process. There are significant challenges. Nevertheless, our organization is well equipped in terms of knowledge, expertise, and experience to fulfill this mandate. With Syria becoming 119th state party to our organization as of 14th October next week, we will be getting closer to the full universality of the convention. The motto of our organization is working together for a world free of chemical weapons. The international community has come together in a visible and significant way to show how this can be done. I thank you, and I will take a few questions before I return to the Executive Council, which is in session at the moment.
About the interaction between your officials and those of the Syrian government. What is the nature of the dialogue and the contact that you're having with the Syrian government?
As I said earlier, some discussions have been held on the disclosure made by the Syrian government on 19th of September during last week in Damascus. The Syrian government has already appointed a focal point also for interaction with our organization. They have at the moment one ambassador from Damascus, from Syrian side in town, and they have also sent two experts who are in fact consulting with our experts during this week, and it may continue during next week also to put together the initial declaration as well as in fact preparing the destruction plan.
How would you characterize the cooperation?
The cooperation has been quite constructive, and I would say that the Syrian authorities have been cooperative.
Robert Nisbet from Sky News. You say that the timelines are tight. Are the timelines unrealistic?
I wouldn't say unrealistic. Much depends also on the situation in the ground. The safety and security of our experts is, of course, an overriding concern. And if the situation does permit, and that's why, actually, we have urged all parties in Syria to be cooperative and to contribute positively to this mission. I think the elimination of those weapons is in the interest of all. Therefore, if we can ensure some cooperation by all parties, and if some temporary ceasefires, in fact, could be established in order to permit our experts to work in a permissive environment, I think the targets could be reached. Of course, there are also questions of logistics and resources, but in terms of resources, we have already received quite encouraging moves from state parties. They have started to contribute to a trust fund that we have established, and I welcome all this.
Takashi with NHK Japan Broadcasting. In terms of the cost that you just mentioned, not only the monetary cost, but also the resources you need, how much, well, first of all, cost you need, and how much resources do you need additionally in terms of what you have already?
The organization, in fact, has the mandate to verify the destruction activities. And the destruction itself is a responsibility of the possessor state, as it happened in the case of other possessor states in the past. Nevertheless, one has to recognize that Syria, which has already declared that it doesn't have the necessary resources to fulfill this, will have to be assisted. And we don't know yet what destruction methods will be. Once we identify them, I think we will have a better picture and we will have an estimate. And then perhaps if the organization is mandated to run this or manage this destruction phase, then we may establish a fund for that.
Anthony Deutsch, Reuters. Can you please tell us a bit about what your inspectors have already found on the ground in terms of the number of sites they have discovered, and what have they so far discovered on the ground in terms of how the chemical weapons are stored in bulk, munitions, etc.? Thank you.
The Syrian government made a disclosure on 19th, and the mandate of the inspectors, in fact, to verify whether this information which was provided is accurate or not. And they only visited one site, as I said earlier. There are over 20 sites that need to be visited in the coming days and weeks. And so far, they are making an inventory of what they found. And today also, they are visiting another site near Damascus. So it's too early, in fact, to make an assessment of, evaluation of these of their findings.
Director-General, take one last question.
Mike Corder from the Associated Press. Director-General, are there any plans yet to visit any sites that have not been declared by Syria, that have been declared by other member states?
As you know, there is such a provision in the Executive Council decision as well as in the Security Council resolution, but we are not yet there, so there wasn't any information submitted to the organization for considering such an inspection to undeclared site. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, as we explained, as I explained earlier, we're going to pivot now to the second part of this briefing, which will be more of a technical nature. On hand, we have, seated to my right, three members who were in Damascus in the last week with the OPCW Advance Team setting up the mission. Mr. Yun Wang on the far right, who is the director of the OPCW External Relations, Dominic Agnelli, who is the head of our Chemical Demilitarization Unit, which oversees destruction activities of chemical weapons, and Mr. Nihad Ali Hodzic, who is the head of the Declarations Unit, which takes in the initial declarations from new states parties. And then to my left is Mr. Malik Elahi, who is a political advisor to the Director General. And Malik and I will be taking most of the questions, those questions that we don't feel do we have enough information, we can refer those to one of the three gentlemen seated on the right. So we'll take the first question right here, Daftali.
Ali Ben David with the Wall Street Journal. I had a question regarding the destruction of the production, mixing, and filling facilities, which I understand is supposed to be completed by the end of the month. So it's already the 9th. I'm just wondering sort of how things are proceeding. The DG talked about two sites being visited. I mean, I'm just trying to get a sense of whether you're sort of on track with the destruction activities to meet that initial deadline of having those facilities eliminated or rendered unusable by the end of the month.
As the Director General mentioned, that operation has just commenced, and the team has in fact done a comprehensive survey of those sites. Photographs have been taken, tags and seals have been put in place, critical equipment has been identified, and it is my understanding that that the effort to make those sites inoperable is well underway.
Right here. And please give your name and your media.
My name is Saito from Mainichi, Japanese Daily. According to the press release, you are destroying the certain Category 3 type of chemical weapon. Weapon means some kind of chemical materials. Do you do neutralize or burn the chemical materials, the toxic materials now?
Category 3 weapons are unfilled munitions. But they are dangerous because those are exactly the munitions which are used together with chemical agents. So destruction of those weapons is a priority, and it is one of the means of ensuring that chemical weapons are not used.
Anthony Deutsch, Reuters. Can you tell us a bit about the type of technology you think will most be needed, and where do you expect to obtain this technology?
I'll give you a general answer, and then maybe I'll ask my colleague Dominique to say a little more on this. These are discussions which are underway. As you know, the EC decision, and which was followed by the Security Council decision, were preceded by a framework agreement between the United States and the Russian Federation. And at that point, discussions had started on looking at the appropriate technologies. It's my understanding that those discussions are continuing. They will have a significant input from the technical secretariat, colleagues like Dominique. So I'll ask Dominique to come and say a little bit more on those.
Yes, thank you, Mike. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Dominique Anelli. I am the head of CDB at the OPCW. And in fact, regarding the destruction of chemical weapons, you have two main technologies for the destruction of chemical weapons. You have the incineration of chemical weapons, or you have the neutralization by agent of the chemical weapons. For the Syrian case, where it's mainly around a certain quantity of precursors, which is still qualified as chemical weapon, in fact, what will be privileged for such a type of precursor, it's a neutralization system. So we are working with our counterpart, we are working with some state parties in order to find and to be able to find a solution to address the chemical weapon stockpile in Syria. And then when this plan of destruction will be mature enough, it will be proceed to the EC. And the EC will have to decide before the 15th November about the timelines of destruction of chemical weapons in Syria. Thank you.
EC meaning our Executive Council.
And CDB meaning Chemical Demilitarization Branch.
This is Jun Nozima from Asahi Shimbun, Japanese Daily. I'd like to ask you that the security issue, so what kind of exactly are you asking for the UN in terms of the security, that kind of the protection? I mean, so do you need any security forces composed by several countries, military forces, something?
I think we've covered this ground before, but let me just repeat that. Primarily, providing security to our teams is the responsibility of the Syrian government. And so far, this is how it has worked. So it's not really up to the OPCW. And then we work with the United Nations, of course, which has a critical role to play in this regard. And the United Nations so far has demonstrated its capabilities, you know, in terms of an investigation of alleged use that had taken place earlier, and also so far in this mission, that that UN is quite capable of working with the Syrians, working with the various parties there, to ensure the kind of security that we need for our operations. So it's not really for us to say if we need a security force or anything of the sort. But Awang has had discussions with you know, his Syrian counterparts when he was in Damascus. I don't know if he wishes to add to that.
Thank you, Malik. Good afternoon. Very much so. Extremely the case that essentially it is the obligation of the Syrian authorities to provide the protection and security. And then on the other hand, we very much rely on our counterparts from the United Nations to provide us with the protection. So this is security and protection. Protection actually comes maybe in two ways. One is information. For instance, where is the secure zone that is really permissible for us to operate? And then the other one is the physical part of, for instance, vehicles and other equipment that ensures our safe operation. Thanks.
In the back here.
Just here, yes.
Benjamin, German Newswire EPD. Ban Ki-moon, the UN Secretary General, said 100 more people would be necessary. Do you agree? How many people do you need?
Obviously, the Secretary General is giving an estimate of the totality of the mission, and he's in a best position to judge how many people on the ground would be required for this joint mission. On our part, we have our own estimates in terms of the technical component of that mission. So it's you're talking about a combined OPCW-UN mission, which is 100 people, and if I'm not mistaken, that has been described as a light footprint in Syria.
And just to add to that, we've said that for this particular stage of verifying the chemical weapons assets, the disclosure of Syria, as well as undertaking this destruction of production facilities and mixing filling equipment, that our assessment is that for that stage we should be able to meet the demand for inspectors from within our own ranks, both people who are on staff and former inspectors that we're calling back who are on a roster and who are available for short-term duty. And just one other something else to add about that is something else we've stressed, that you know, this is a very high-risk mission. And that being the case, all of the inspectors from the OPCW who don't normally aren't called upon to work in these kind of situations are doing this on a voluntary basis. Nobody's being ordered into the field. They are signing up to this. And we've had no shortage of sign-ups. Our inspectors really believe in this mission, and they're prepared to go out and run those risks to complete this verification element. Right here, Tony.
So, of course, the Syrian government has now said they're cooperating, and you say that the cooperation so far has been good. But, of course, the government forces are engaged in a war with opposition forces. How do you anticipate getting to stockpiles or weapons that are not in areas under Syrian government force control?
The Syrian government will have to find ways of doing it. The United Nations, you know, there's a Security Council resolution. The UN Security Council resolution is a more comprehensive framework, you know, to address the larger issues pertaining to Syria. We are absolutely confident on the ability of our colleagues from United Nations to work with, you know, all groups within Syria to create those conditions. And we also expect, and the Director General has said it a number of times already, that members of the international community who have any influence in Syria will use that influence to create the conditions that we require to do our job. Thank you.
Bülent Moran, TRT.
Will the destruction of chemical weapons just take place in Syria, or is there any possibility to transport these chemicals to another country for destruction because of the civil war?
If there's a technical dimension to this question, I'll defer to Dominique, but I think politically it's too early to say anything about any such plans. As I said, we are in day 9 of the mission. You know, the initial survey has just about been completed. The very first verification destruction activities has just about begun. So I think it's a little premature to go down that road. Dominique, would you like to add to that or no? Okay. That's it. Yeah.
Anybody on this side, Takashi?
Yes, DG mentioned his hope to get a kind of ceasefire on the ground. Are there any kind of concrete discussion, political discussion going on to get the political agreement on the possible ceasefire on the ground?
There are all kinds of discussions that go on in New York all the time. I'm not in a position to comment on any specifics of discussions that are particularly relevant to the ceasefire aspect. I think this might be a question better answered by our colleagues in New York.
My call from AP, just to follow on from that, I understood from the Director General's remarks that in some situations a ceasefire would be necessary for you to go in and check these sites. Is that correct?
At the moment, there are, of course, certain sites that are located in areas which are dangerous, you know, and we haven't started our inspection work in those sites yet, but soon we would be required to do so. So I think at that point it would be necessary for us to be assured that conditions on the ground are such that we can and our teams can proceed to do their work in safety in those areas.
You mentioned that this is not a normal situation for the members of the team to work in. What kind of training did they have to work in the circumstances that there are in Syria?
Susanna
Koster, France 24.
Thank you. There actually is a training going on this week to prepare our next group of inspectors to go into the kind of conditions that prevail right now in Syria. Beyond that, you know, our inspectors are no strangers to harsh working conditions. We've pointed out that it's extremely hot in Damascus these days, and our guys and women have to do that work in chemical protection gear as well as personal protection gear, flak jackets and helmets and so forth. So, you know, they're quite durable. But as far as the security dimension, yeah, there are trainings going on now to prepare groups of inspectors to go in and be able to cope with those circumstances.
Can you say a little bit about the training itself, what it entails?
Yes, merci, cher collègue. I will continue in English. Yes, the training, in fact, the inspector at the OPCW, we are all trained to wear our full protective equipment. It's part of our daily duty to do that. So, in fact, if you are an inspector and you are not able to carry on with the full IP and the mask, you are not able to be deployable in some area of activities. So it's our daily duty. So there is nothing new regarding this. The only new aspect regarding Syria, it's a security environment. And the security environment are explained by Malik. It's taking care into account by Syria and UNDSS. Thank you. I hope I answer. Regarding the training, we have different training activities within different state parties. They provide us some live agent training where, in fact, we carry on our activities as protection, detection, decontamination, health and safety issues under live agent environment. So we used to do that. Yes, I expect it answers your questions. Thank you.
Daftali.
that there were more than 20 sites. I was wondering if it's possible.
Naftali Ben David, Wall Street Journal. The DG mentioned that there were more than 20 sites, and I was wondering if it was possible to get any more specificity on how many sites, and also whether those are all sites that include production, mixing, and filling, or whether some of those are solely storage and therefore wouldn't necessarily be dealt with during this first phase.
I don't think we want to go beyond what the Director General had to say about that. As we know, these disclosures is confidential information, so I think that's as far as we'll want to go.
But it does include all sites that are relevant to the Syrian chemical weapons program. So production, storage, research, you know, in the case of the Security Council and EC decisions, mixing and filling facilities as well.
I have a question about the team. How many women or men are there?
Well, there are teams and teams. The first team that went in consists of 19 from the OPCW and 14 and later on 16 from the UN side. Unfortunately, from the OPCW side, there were no ladies. And then, of course, but from the UN team, I think there were four from the field operations. That's the balance. But this is only the advanced team. And in future, there will be really teams coming in to join. But then, of course, the operation will require that actually you minimize the footprint as far as possible to the extent this is efficient and workable arrangement, but on the other, this is physically supportable. And based on that, of course, there will be rotations. Thank you.
Here in the back.
My name is Jun Nagata. I'm a reporter of Japanese news agency Kyodo News. I have two questions. So one question is, again, concerning security. So you said it's the obligation of Syrian government to give you a protection, security protection. But the Syrian government, I think in media interview or something like that, they said so they cannot provide any protection for the sites which are located in dissident control area. So how do you comment on that? What would you do for that? And the second question is, again, the number of members of the team. So you're deploying the second team, and I'd like to clarify, how many will there as a second team, and have they already reached Syria?
On the first question, you can't treat security as a static concept. It's a dynamic situation. It's a fluid situation. It changes on a daily basis. And that's why we work very closely with the United Nations. So for any particular move that the team has to undertake, you know, the security situation is assessed, and unless we get that clearance from our colleagues from the United Nations, we don't move. And of course, in this process, the Syrian government also has a say. As far as the OPCW component of the mission is concerned, it will only go and conduct its mission and part of its activities if it is assured that security on a given day, on a given schedule, is provided. And as I said, you know, it's fluid. It keeps changing. So plans can change at the last minute, given the security situation. You may head to another site rather than the site that you chose initially. So you have to look at this operation in this sort of dynamic situation. And I believe what you're referring to, the statement of the Syrian Deputy Foreign Minister, was made in that context, that on a given day, if there is a certain plan, they would suggest changes to that plan because a particular site or a particular area may not be secure. And I think that's a sensible thing to do. You had a second part to your question, which is about the numbers. Well, as the Director General said, I think we are sending 12 people, and they are probably on their way to Damascus right now. And this will complement the advanced team minus the three gentlemen here who have already been there.
Sure.
Again, Japanese theory, Mainichi, my name is Saito. Two questions to Mr. Aneri. I understand it's premature to discuss the method of destruction, but according to the news report, USA is ready to provide mobile equipment, namely incineration mobile equipment. Is it possible to accept such an offer and to bring some mobile incineration equipment to bring to Syria? And second question is, according to the news report, Norway, the USA and Russia asked Norway to dispose this chemical weapons. Is it true, and is it possible?
I don't know if you're asking us to comment on rumors or press reports. I think that's not appropriate for us. The technology package, which is most suitable to the Syrian conditions, I'm sure people will agree on that. It could be mobile, it could be static. We don't know yet. These are all discussions that are in a preliminary stage. And, you know, this is a very serious endeavor to get rid of highly dangerous and toxic weapons. And, you know, spur-of-the-moment decisions are never taken in these situations. It would require very serious deliberations, which are, you know, in keeping with the provisions of the convention also, that destruction has to take place under situations and circumstances which are safe for people and the environment.
Excuse me, just to add to that, there's been a number of cases with other states parties who joined the convention and who declared chemical weapons stockpiles that had to be verified by us and then destroyed under our supervision. And those countries did not have the resources, either financial or perhaps technical, excuse me, to do that. And so an offer was made by another state party or states parties. And so the current situation in Syria, as the Director General mentioned, Syrian government has already said it does not have its own resources to undertake all of this destruction work and will require assistance. And that is a prerogative of other states' parties. We have established trust funds, and states' parties will expectedly be making offers. And that can be in kind, in the way of equipment, so forth, or it can be in cash. But they can all stump up and add to the capacity of the Syrian government to destroy its arsenal. Anyone else have? Dominic? Next question?
Right here.
Hi, Turkish Radio Television. Aykut Yıldır. Were you able to detect, or is it possible to detect, the country of origins of the mechanical and the chemical, you know, materials used in the chemical weapons? Have you detected anything, or is it possible to detect the country of origins?
Well, if it were, we wouldn't be at liberty to say. That's all part of the confidentiality agreement, that what is declared to us and what we verify, it's confidential information between us and the state party and the other states' parties to the OPCW. Right here.
Sorry, Barnaby Phillips from Al Jazeera. Is it possible to say that the weapons that you've seen so far and the dismantling that's begun, were they weapons that were poised for use, as it were, or were they in deep storage?
These are interesting terms, poised for use or deep storage. I don't know if Dominique has ever encountered those.
I don't know if I understood.
No, I think these are kinds of judgments that probably we shouldn't be making. All countries have a different military philosophy with respect to all their weapons systems, so it's very difficult to judge intentions.
Well, just to add to that, we did say these were unfilled munitions. And what that means is that you have two parts of a chemical weapon. You've got the chemical weapon agent, sarin, VX, sulfur mustard, something else. And then you've got the munition, which is used to deploy it. And there are certain munitions that are specifically designed for use with chemical weapons. And it's those kind of munitions that have been already, some of them have already been destroyed under our verification.
Anything to add to that, Tommy? Yeah. Okay. Daftali.
Do you guys have an estimate of the total number of inspectors or experts that will be needed over the overall course of the program, that is to say throughout the first half of 2014? I realize you probably don't have an exact specific number, but do you have a ballpark? And a second and perhaps easier question is just how many of the first team remain in country? Is it everybody but these three? I guess it wasn't clear on how many of the first team are still there. 16. So it's 19 and then you three are, okay. Yeah.
15 plus 12, okay. So they'll be 27. No, I mean, with respect to your first question, it all depends on what are the destruction plans that eventually get approved, which would require OPCW activities in terms of verification of destruction. So I think it would be, again, premature to speculate on how many people in terms of inspectors do we need for the kinds of time periods that you've mentioned. We do work on the basis of very systematic estimates. Ballpark figures are a little, dangerous. Yes, I think it's been stated before that that it won't be hundreds, it would be in tens.
And just to add to that, to clarify something, when we're in the stage of verifying the declaration or the disclosure and going to these sites, these are in and out visits. They go in, they quantify, they leave, they seal stuff. And then that's subject to destruction. But when you get into destruction verification, what that means is that our inspectors have to be there and witness every single moment of destruction activity. And that consumes a lot of inspector days. To date, with the OPCW, more than 80% of all of our inspector days in the first 16 years of the organization have been devoted to chemical demilitarization inspections, because you have to stay on site 24/7. A lot of chemical weapons destruction facilities operate around the clock, and so we have to have teams of inspectors who can stay on the clock at all times to be counting down the destruction of every kilo of chemical weapons agent and every munition that's being destroyed.
That's for
chemical weapons, yeah.
From the equipment of the production facility.
Over here, yes.
I'm Ryoichi Teraguchi from Japan Daily Yomiuri Shimbun. Do you see any other challenges to destroy chemical weapons? So, I mean, I would like to know your initial assessment of the storage condition of the chemical weapons in Syria.
We've mentioned a number of challenges, so I again don't want to speculate if there are any other challenges. As work goes along, there might be other, challenges that emerge. We'll deal with those as they come. And I think at this stage, again, it's since we haven't completed our first round of verification activities, it's again premature to comment on the condition of any facility or site. It's probably not appropriate for me to do so.
Takashi. Yeah, in terms of the chemicals, I understand that there's about 1,000 tons of them. But among them, you mentioned mainly they are precursors. How does it affect your timeline? If it's more of agent rather than precursor, how does it prolong your activity?
In general, it doesn't affect the timelines that much, because the different technologies may be applied to destruction of different types of chemicals. And this is what is going on right now, the discussions about the destruction methods and the timelines. So the main timelines are set for in the decisions of that we are going by, decision of the Executive Council. But the destruction methods for particular chemicals are still being negotiated. So.
We'll have time for two more questions, if we have two more questions. One more question? Going once. Over here, yes.
I make the correspondent. The factories where they can produce the chemical weapons, do they also have the possibility to build conventional weapons? And what will they do with that?
I can answer that pretty briefly. In some cases, with chemical weapons production facilities, if it's agreed by our executive council, they don't have to be destroyed. They could be converted for peaceful uses. And, of course, we verify that. We approve it up front. We verify it. We continue to visit those plants for, I think, it's 10 years after they 10 plus 5. But that's a minority of cases. In most cases, chemical weapons production facilities under the convention not only have to be destroyed, they have to be erased from the face of the earth. So it means taken down to nothing, to junk. Irreversibly destroyed is the language. But in this first phase, we're talking about making them inoperable. In the first instance, to make them inoperable, to either destroy or to remove the essential elements of a production plant that are needed to run it. And without that, it can't run. It's inoperable. In lieu of getting on with the actual destruction of those facilities. And that same thing goes for mixing and filling. Anything to add to that?
Just a bit about the question. I think it was about using that to produce other weapons. Yeah, so that's not peaceful purposes, clearly.
Do we have a last question? Good. We'll have a wrap then. Thank you very much.
Thank you.